Let me add my quick welcome to all of you as well. It's great to see you here. This is our, I guess, already our fifth event in Britten 100, our celebration. We're actually performing almost every single one of his works other than the major stage works. Like, we're not doing any of the operas, and I suppose we're not doing Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra. But other than that, we're doing about 95 works, something like this. I want to just say a little something about the two works today. First, I'll just say about the Serenade. This is probably one of his great masterworks. And it's been fascinating to me because I'm also playing some of the song cycles with some other artists, and we've been rehearsing the past couple of weeks. And it's really incredibly difficult to get to interpret the texts and to get a sense of what Britten's doing with them, and especially the texts that were written in the sort of 1930s and some of the earlier texts as well. So Britten really, how would I put this? I think he's creating sort of tone poems with the text. Sometimes he specifically sets text, and it's obvious, like the hymn where there's a horn call and sort of a sprightly tenor part. But as an overall piece, he's really creating epic forms. The Serenade in particular, like last week's Nocturne, is based on sort of evening, night, and Compline by Candlelight, which happens every Sunday night. There's a great statement, which is, it is night after a long day. And Britten really focuses on this time of the day. And I have a little quote. I have several quotes, actually, but I'll just do one right now. This is the dedicatee of the work is Edward Sackville West, and he helped compile the text. But he sort of thinks about the evening as the cloak of evil, the worm in the rose, the sense of sin in the heart of man. So heavy stuff for a 1 o'clock concert. But it got dark outside, so we're on our way. So this is an incredible work of different moods, different feelings, and it begins and ends with, I think, something that's become standard in the horn literature, which is that Britten starts and ends this with just a soliloquy for the solo horn. Would you feel comfortable demonstrating the overtone series? This is the overtone series of the horn. Did you fix it? Can you make it more broken? So that's actually the natural overtones on this long pipe. How long is this pipe? About 13 feet. If you turn around and look at those pipes, you know, same way the organ works, if those were actually pipes, but anyway. The overtone series are the natural notes that exist over a certain pitch, and the amount of pressure, breath pressure that she applies to the instrument affects which one is going to come out. And the natural form of the harmonics, the higher partials are all out of tune, as you just heard. And traditionally, the horn player with his or her hand will alter, or embouchure as well, will alter a little bit to fix the out of tune, and they spend their whole life doing that. So what Britten has asked for is for them not to do that, but for them to leave it sounding out of tune, so that the fourth scale degree and the seventh scale degree are going to be juicy. So just to warn you there, and that's all part of it, okay? Yes, the horn player always likes the audience to know that. And it's really an incredible feature, and it gives you this otherworldly effect to the work as well. So this is the Serenade for tenor, horn, and string orchestra.
Thank you. clock shades thrice the ground that it would stop, whilst the spouse rippling following them appears a mighty body thing.
Flying, and answer echo.
Thank you. Queen and huntress, chaste and fair, now the sun is laid to sleep, seated in night's silver chair, state in wonted manner keep. Hesperus entreats thy light, Hesperus entreats thy light. Excellently bright. Earth, let not thy envious shade dare itself to interpose, since whose shining orb was made help to clear when day did close. Bless us then with wish and sight. Bless us then with wish and sight. Goddess, 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 excellently bright. Lay thy form of pearl apart, and its crystal shining quiver give unto the flying heart space to breathe, how short soever. Thou that makes the day of night, thou that makes the day of night, thou that makes the goddess, 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 excellently bright.
Again, thanks for being here. As you notice in your brochure, and somebody asked me if we were going to be doing the same kind of in-depth, thick brochure that we did for the Stravinsky Festival and our Tenebrae and all of that. If we were to undertake such an effort, the book would be this thick. And we would definitely have to do fewer concerts to pay for it. So I hope you're okay with that. We just have a listing and a little chatting. Maybe some of you are not okay with the chatting, but sorry. So, do I see Judy Hancock? Is that who I see? Okay, so sorry, I have to do this. Judith Hancock was one of the first people to give me confidence about music. I don't know if you know that. It was in the hallway of the St. Thomas Choir School. She was the associate organist with Dr. Jerry Hancock at the time. And I was singing, walking down the hall, and she said, why don't you do that all the time when you're in service? Why don't you stand up and just be recognized? So actually taking on the theme of education, a lot of really everything we do here is about education, whether it's for our own education, getting to learn all these incredible works. But you'll notice that the orchestra here, NOVUS New York, which is a relatively new orchestra, just a couple years old, is made up primarily of people who are either just out of university or within the past decade, which is definitely still young in the world of, right, oh, and I'm not quite sure about you, but. So we have graduates from ACJW, from Juilliard, all the local schools, but it's a great way for us to make music together and to sort of bridge the gap between the innocence of youthful conservatorism and the thing that's on the other side of that, whatever that might be. Yes, okay. So the other thing that we do here at Trinity within the Trinity Choir is I always try to activate some of our great singers to do works like this. So our soprano soloist for Les Illuminations is Sarah Brailey. She joined the Trinity Choir about a year ago. Just an incredible artist, an incredible voice to do a piece of this intensity. I should also mention, I hope it's okay to mention that was Danielle's very first serenade. So I made brief allusion to Britten and text. Britten really got to have an awareness of text through W.H. Auden, one of the great poets of the 20th century and librettists. He's the librettist of The Rake's Progress. He wrote many, many texts specifically for Britten, but more than that, I think he educated him and opened Britten's eyes to the possibility of literature, both prose and poetry. Which is, the next piece is not by Auden, but rather, Britten never would have come to know the work of Rimbaud had it not been for Auden. And so sort of got him into a more sophisticated understanding of things. There's so much to say about this setting. You'll hear it. Its main themes are sort of the theatricality of life, chaos, big cities, the tragic, painful aspects of beauty, all of this. There's one set of texts that comes three times. Je suis la clé de cette parade sauvage, which is I alone have the key to this savage parade. So the idea with this is that perhaps Britten's view of Rimbaud's poetry is that only the artist observing the world from the outside can hope to make sense of the savage parade that is life. This happens three times. It opens it, it's in the middle of the interlude, and at the very end. It's really kind of a perfect piece for Lower Manhattan and on September 12th. So this work, just a couple things about some of the movements, because Britten has a quote here. Britten on the second one says, this poem, I believe, was written in London and certainly is a very good impression of the chaotic modern city life. I want it sung in a metallic and relentless fashion with the exclamation, ce sont des villes, somewhat sarcastically sung. And the end is simply a prayer for a little piece. Now, I don't think Sarah can possibly sing metallically, but that's interesting that that's Britten's intention there. Being Beauteous was actually dedicated to Peter Pears and is a declaration of love to Britten's lifelong companion, and it's written early during their relationship. Again, very striking that someone would be that brave in 1939 in Europe. So without further ado, please help me in welcoming Sarah Brailey to the stage, who will sing Les Illuminations for you.
Oh,